Welcome to part two of the series of videos on Chief Mate's orals preparation. I'll give you the link to part one in the description section below, but these videos have been made to help prepare deck officers who are appearing for Chief Mate's oral examination. I'll be taking randomly 7 or 8 questions and discussing them every time. So I hope to cover a lot of these questions in the series of videos that I'm preparing. So let me start with the first question. First question is, you're the chief officer. How would you prepare for heavy weather or rough seas, or maybe you are going to encounter a tropical revolving storms or the effects of tropical revolving storm? How would you prepare yourself for heavy weather? So as a chief officer, this is how you should be answering to the oral examiner. So you would of course inform the master, the engine room, the crew and other departments such as the catering department or the galley. When master on bridge, ask the master, ask him if it is required to plot alternate courses, show him the recent weather reports, square and secure up the bridge, make sure there are no loose items around, always wear proper protective equipment and organize respective crew with their protective equipment, especially when going on deck, to secure the items as well. There should not be any loose items, so check all movable objects and make sure they are secured above as well as below decks, particularly in the engine room, galley, storerooms, paint locker or the bosun store. Alright, so make sure all these items are secured, otherwise in heavy weather they might be moving around, it might sometimes cause injuries as well. Check whether your ship's accommodation has been secured and all ports and dead lights closed. No porthole should be opened. It should be closed. If you have weathertight, watertight doors, they should be closed as well. Boat deck, make sure your lifeboat is well secured, your life rafts are well secured as well. Check the gripes, check for the lashings, make sure they're absolutely secured. Check for any weather deck openings being secured. So your hatch access, your doors, air and bilge pipes to be covered, your sounding caps should be closed, mooring winches to be covered as well, as well as the electrical circuits of the mooring winches so that it doesn't get damaged with the water spray or the sea spray coming in from the outside. You would also further on deck rig the safety line or hand rope on the deck on both sides from forward to aft. Make sure our hatches are battened down. Gangways to be extra lashed and properly secured. This I can give you a personal experience that on one of my ships we actually had a damage to the gangway because it was not properly lashed and secured. If required, you can put extra lashings on the gangway and make sure it's secured. Close all the watertight, weathertight doors. Make sure your mooring ropes need to be lashed. Put extra lashing on the mooring ropes if required. Otherwise, sometimes they can fly around in heavy weather. Very difficult to get them back. All loose gears, drums, etc. on deck to be secured and lashed. The anchors to be extra lashed and secured. Make sure the spurling pipe is covered as well. The scuppers and outlets to be kept open on deck so that the water can drain through. The water that will come as a sea spray on deck can drain through. The soundings should be checked regularly. Of course, it's sometimes unsafe for anybody to go on deck and check the sounding. So make sure you send people in pairs and avoid it. If it's too bad of weather, then you need to avoid it. But if possible, if it's safe to do so, then make sure you keep checking the soundings so that there's no ingress of water. It helps you to check whether there is any ingress of water in any tank or not. Similarly, bilges of the cargo holds should also be checked for sounding. Alright, make sure once you've done everything, you've checking everything, you're logging all this information down and informing the master. It's important for you to log down all the actions that you have taken because it helps you tomorrow if there's any damage, if there is any reports, any claims for damage, then you can show these documents, relevant documents, to the insurers and show them that you took all the adequate action and still there was a damage which was out of your control. Ballast conditions should be checked and conveyed. Free surface effect should be reduced. Make sure your tanks are either topped up or completely empty, because if the vessel will be rolling and pitching in the heavy weather, and if you have slack tanks, then the free surface effect adds to the reduction of the GM. There's a virtual loss of GM and the ship may behave differently. Cargo lashings, of course, I cannot reinforce this enough, that cargo lashings should be tightened and should be checked regularly if it's safe to do so, and crew should be checked and sent in groups. They should be walking on the deck using the safety lines and making sure that the lashings are secured. So crew to be warned to avoid going to the upper deck areas, as if it can be avoided, they should be working indoors except for checking of the lashings and checking of whether the lifeboats, life rafts are secured or not. Other than that, they should be working indoors. Instructions should be issued on following weather reports, transmitting weather reports to the authorities in case of tropical revolving storms, danger messages in accordance with the SOLAS. The next question is, how do you prepare a ship for loading dangerous goods? So if you're the chief officer, how do you prepare a ship for loading dangerous goods? So you would, of course, work as per the supervision and instruction from the master. You should be aware of the cargo type and location. You should be consulting the IMDG, that is the International Maritime Dangerous Goods Manual, and perhaps also the loading manual, and loading as per segregation table of the IMDG. Make sure that you establish communication wearing personal protective equipment for yourself as well as some crew on duty when this cargo is being loaded. The reason is that sometimes these cargoes, they emit fumes that may not be seen. There could be leaks from such cargo, leaks that can lead to some kind of poisoning or some kind of corrosion. So it's always a good idea that when these dangerous goods are being loaded onto the ship, then you are wearing protective equipment. Always take precaution. You should read up about this cargo from the IMDG, and you should know everything about such cargoes, what precautions to be taken, what to do if there's any medical emergency, what if you see leaks of such cargo, how should you approach the cargo. You should be getting the cargo details from the shipper, what type of packages it is, quantity, weight, stowage factor, labels should be provided as well, because you need to label such cargo. If it's a dangerous goods, you should be using the IMDG labels and labeling on all the sides of the cargo. This is required by law as well. You should make sure the holds are ready for loading such cargo. There are specific holds. Now, most of the ships, if are loading dangerous goods, there are specific holds designated for loading dangerous goods sometimes. Normally, they are away from the accommodation. So make sure you're aware of that and you are loading in those specific holds as well. All right. You should also display a Bravo flag during the day, and nighttime you should display a red light when these goods are being loaded. Dangerous goods should, well, you should prioritize to be loaded so that you can load it during the daylight hours, but sometimes in some ports they also load it during the night. But if you can, load it during the day, because it's easier for you to spot any damages or any leaks or any kind of discharges from such cargo. Stop other cargo work and bunkering if in progress, and make sure that there is no hot work welding going on when you are loading the dangerous goods. If it is in hold, check for temperatures in hold, especially if it is required to be maintained at certain temperatures. Provision of special lifting gear to prevent damage to cargo when handling. So if it is you that's going to be lifting the cargo, if your vessel needs to use its own lifting gear, so make sure your lifting gear is adequately equipped to lift such a heavy the dangerous goods. Compartments containing the dangerous goods having explosive or fire hazard should have firefighting equipments rigged for immediate use. Appropriate measures should be taken to render any kind of spillage harmless. When there is leakage or escape of dangerous gases or vapors, the area should be evacuated, ventilated, and tested before entry. And when dealing with spillages or removal of defective packages, suitable breathing apparatus sets and protective clothing should be provided as per the circumstances. You should also be very aware of all the medical issues that can occur during handling of such goods, and read up on it and make sure that you have the protective equipment to protect yourself as well as your crew. The next question is, describe the chief officer's duties for dropping anchor. So before you drop anchor, you need to establish communication, of course, with the master and the bridge as well as with the bosun. Establish communication, then of course obtain instructions from the master. Make sure you and master have clearly communicated on what is expected and what are you to be required to be doing the cargo or during the anchor operations. Which side of the anchor should you be using, whether it's a port anchor or starboard anchor, make sure you clearly understand and clearly communicate with the masters. I have seen in the past, in my experience, where chief officers have made certain assumptions, they have not clearly communicated, or sometimes they could not hear what the master is saying. You should also ask the master how many shackles to be using. Wear protective equipment, protect yourself, because sometimes when you let go of the anchor, there is a lot of dust and pieces floating around in the air, and sometimes it can hurt your eyes, so make sure that your eyes are protected. Take the right tools for the job. So if the bosun is going with you, make sure that the bosun is carrying all the right tools which will require to open up the anchor lashing or put back the anchor lashing, securing the swirling pipe, so on and so forth. Check for the lighting. If it's during the night, make sure the forward part of the vessel is lighted enough for you to be able to see and what to be doing. Check for power on deck, winch, operate your winches, operate your windlasses. Sometimes this has also happened that the bosun has gone forward and chief officer has gone forward, they haven't checked. It's always a good idea to walk back your anchor. So that is just dropping the anchor out from the hose pipe and making sure that the windlass and winch is working. Any kind of unnecessary obstructions such as or slippery spaces, ropes near cable should be removed. That place should be absolutely clear so that nobody trips and falls and hurts themselves. There should not be any obstructions overboard. So before you drop the anchor, make sure you have a look overboard. Sometimes we drop anchors in places where there are a lot of fishing boats around. You go into an area where there are a lot of fishing boats or people fishing, and make sure no small dinghies or boats are floating around in those areas. And if you drop anchor on them, there will be a big chaos. Make sure that the anchor brakes are one tight since connecting to the gear. So make sure your windlass brakes, your anchor brakes are working. And to make sure that if there is any incident that requires you to apply those brakes, they should be working. Remove the anchor lashings, engage the gear to ensure that the anchor can be dropped effectively. You should also check the overboard side that it's clear. Lower the anchor up to the water level. We call it the cockable position. Put back on brake and out of gear. Inform the master on bridge when you're ready and await instructions for letting go. When ordered to let go, make sure that you confirm with the master. The master is asking to let go. Do not let go before the master tells you to do so. Release the full brake till it touches the ground and moves. Stop. Allow further to drop up to required level and start controlling the brake. All right. Once informed to stop, hold on, immediately put on the brakes. Count the required shackle is at in and inform the master. Inform from time to time the position of the cable to the bridge once anchor touches the ground. Display the day and night signals as required. Tighten the brakes, the windlass brakes, devil's claws, etc. Sometimes in some areas, if you are in areas where it is prone to piracy, make sure your swirling pipes, hose pipes, they are all covered. Nobody should be able to board your vessel using the anchor and climb into the vessel. Wait for the vessel to be brought up and inform the master. Take care about the safety of life throughout and make sure that both anchors are always ready to let go. Right, because sometimes it might happen that if one anchor is suddenly not working, you should be able to immediately let go the next anchor. But do not let go both the anchors at the same time unless it's a special requirement. All right, normally if you let masters avoid letting go both anchors unless it's a special requirement, otherwise sometimes these anchor chains can entangle themselves. That's another problem. All right. Then the question is, how do you prepare the ship for dry dock as a chief officer? So if you are preparing the ship for dry dock, make sure all hatches and beams are stored, derricks and cranes to be down and stored as well. Eliminate all free surface effect from tanks. So either keep the tanks empty or keep the tanks full so that there is no reduction of GM. Adequate GM should be checked prior to entry to dry dock. You should consult the dry dock inspector and they will recommend a GM, and you have to advise the dry dock about the GM that your vessel has. GM stands for, of course, the meter center, the transverse meter center. That is basically an indication of your ship's stability. Consult on the draft and the trim that will be required for your vessel to enter the docks. Check the sounding of all tanks. Secure and lock up all the spaces. Lock up the toilets that you don't want the dry dock workers to use. Rig fenders to prevent any damage to the ship, Sometimes you have tires, huge those industrial tires available to be used as fenders to prevent any damage to the ships. Prepare your dry dock plan, shell expansion plan for the dry dock inspectors. Obtain facilities of water, power, access and garbage disposal. Take a sounding around the blocks to make sure that the vessel is safely sitting on the blocks. Prepare a repair list, and this starts a few months in advance to allow for cost and time estimates. Normally the ship's officers or the chief officer and the master does this with the in consultation with the superintendent of the ships, and this starts a few months in advance. The dry dock plan and the shell expansion plan should be prepared and ready to show the underwater appendages, the echo sounders, the transducers, the bilge keels, stabilizers, to make sure that the vessel sits properly on the block without any damage to any of these appendages. In terms of repair and dry dock list, some of the standard items that you would be including is hull cleaning, surface preparation, painting, inspection and overhaul of anchors and cables, including ranging and marking, inspection and cleaning and painting of cable lockers, because it's difficult to access cable lockers during normal operations when you are at sea. You need to get all this done during the dry dock only. Plugs to be taken out, plugs to be taken from all bottom and peak tanks, and the plugs to be labeled and retained by the chief officer and replaced before the dry dock is flooded. All sea valves and sea chests to be inspected, overhauled and painted. Inspection, overhaul and load test of all lifting appliances should be carried out. All tank hold compartments and their closing appliances to be inspected and overhauled. Inspection, overhaul and load test of all lifting appliances should be done. All anodes to be inspected, the location and weight size to be ascertained. If you want some anodes to be replaced, you can order that as well. Survey of the ship's bottom, known as sighting the bottom, should also be conducted. In the repair items, renewal of pipings, cargo handling equipment, hatch closing arrangements, bulkhead leaks, hull structure damage, replacement of ship side rails, instrumentation and control equipment refurbishing, any kind of electrical cables, heavy weather damage, overhaul of firefighting and life-saving appliances, all this can be done. Any kind of modification, which includes firefighting systems or fixed firefighting systems, firefighting detection systems, structural arrangements and piping arrangements, inert gas systems, life-saving appliances, conversion or restructuring in order to comply with some new mandatory equipment requirements can also be ordered during the dry dock. Alright, so dry dock is mainly to conduct a maintenance of items that cannot be maintained by the ship's crew during normal operations, or to conduct or carry out major structural changes, maintenance of equipments and structures which are always in use during a ship's voyage. Finally, the logbook entries. When entering, make sure that you enter the time stern clears the gates, what time the pumping of the dry dock water commenced, when were the lines sent ashore forward and aft to secure the vessel, time of touching the blocks, time all sewn on blocks, time gangway walkable, vessel certified gas-free, what time was dock draining completed, and note details of special shores blocks and the arrangements. What time were the utilities connected? So when we say utilities, that includes power, water, firefighting arrangements, so on and so forth, because you cannot generate water, so you will not have your ship's own water, you will not have ship's power, you cannot use the generators, so you will be taking the generator or the power from the dry dock. When coming out of the dry dock, make sure you note down the time of flooding commenced. This is after the time of signing the authority to flood certificate. The dry dock period is normally docked every 2 years. This can be extended to about 2.5 years. And for docking with cargo on board, make sure your cargo plan is provided to the dry dock workers, and additional shore blocks placed under unsupported cargo holds. All right, normally ships avoid going into the dry dock with a cargo, but sometimes in cases of emergencies or if cannot be avoided, vessels have been known to go into the dry dock with the cargo on board. All right, it becomes a bit more complicated, but because many of the maintenance cannot be done, that's why ships prefer to be going in absolutely empty, so that whole ship can be whole ship can undergo maintenance. All right, so I hope this video was useful to you guys. If there is any question that you want me to cover in particular, let me know, but I'll be covering randomly a lot of different questions in my future videos. So stay tuned, keep subscribing, keep watching, and all the best with your studies. Bye guys.